because we're supposed to decouple with bacteria. You also should not clean out your colon or get rid of rotten food. We have a natural cleansing capacity of our own bodies, and we should actually cherish the microbes that we have in our guts. So, like I said before, we have rich communities in our bodies, and most of these microbial communities consist of bacteria. But there's also archaea and fungi and yeast in our bodies, but most of them are bacteria, so that's well what my talk will be focused on. And most of these live in our gut, but they're also, like I said before, we have them in on our skin and in our mouths. And if you have one, a vagina, they live there as well. And the richest communities are in our distal gut, and there are about 10 to the 13th microbes there, 100 trillion microbes. And that's probably as many cells as we have in our bodies, which is of course a very hard calculation to do, it's a lot of guesswork, but we'll probably have as many bacteria as we have human cells in our bodies. So that's something to keep in mind. They might actually sometimes outnumber us. And they weigh about like 1 to 2 kilos. And most of these are called either beneficial symbionts, that's a term you might hear before, but they're usually called the human microbiome together, all these communities. You also hear the term microbiota. That's usually referred to when we really talk about which microbes there are. Well, human microbiome refers to not only the microbes, but also their genomes and their capacities, so what they can do for us. But both terms are used, you know, they're sort of both covering the same thing. So, like I said, most of these microbes live in our gut, and they have a lot of functions for us. They're important for our health. So there's in terms of genes, they actually have 100 times more genes together than human genes. So the human genome is a couple of thousand, I forgot, but like the microbes add an enormous capacity to the enzymatic functions that we have in our bodies. They can break down things we can not break down ourselves. And that's actually what they do in our gut. So what they do is they ferment or digest all the complex carbohydrates that we humans cannot digest. So when you have when you eat food, it will first go, of course, in your stomach, and then it will go to your small intestine, where our human enzymes will break down the food and we can absorb it. But there's still a lot of things we cannot digest, like fibers and you know, very complex proteins and carbohydrates. And so those are then move on to the large intestine, and that's where the bacteria can actually get their share of the food we eat. And they can break down, with all these enzymes that they have, they can break down these fibers and convert them to other chemical molecules, such as butyrate. Most of these are small chain fatty acids. And those molecules that they make out of the food we cannot digest are the molecules that are good for our bodies. It's still not really known how they can exert all their functions on our human functions, but it's actually even believed that they can go to our brain and have some functions there. They're also, the small chain fatty acids also serve as fuel for intestinal cells, but they're probably also signal molecules that can go to the rest of our body and signal over there. And I'll talk a little bit about that more later on in my talk. But other than breaking down and extracting energy from food that we ourselves cannot extract, they also have other functions. They're important for our immune system and to educate that well. It's known from germ-free mice, so animals that grow up completely sterile without any bacteria, those have an inherent immune system, and they also have other anatomical features in their guts that are not well developed. So gut microbes probably educate both our immune system as well as the proper development of our gut, like villi, all the structures we have in our gut. And last but not least, they also occupy a lot of niches. Basically, let's say this room was full of people and another person would come in and try to steal a chair, they wouldn't find a chair because it's all occupied. So similar to that, because our guts are full with beneficial microbes, there's less room for pathogens to enter. It's much harder for them to compete with the spaces and the food that is there. And so the gut microbes also protect us against invaders. And I was tossing this slide because I'm Dutch. Because it was believed that the first person to ever see human-associated microbes, or any microbes, might have been Antonie van Leeuwenhoek. Now, there's some debate whether it was him, but I strongly believe it was him, because he's Dutch. And so Antonie van Leeuwenhoek built, he wasn't a scientist, he was actually worked in the fabric industry. And one of the instruments they had in the 17th century was sort of a lens to look at fabric, to look at what quality it was. And so he was used to working with these glass lenses. And turns out that he was actually very good in making them. And he started to build a simple microscope, not anything like the microscope you might use in class. They actually look like you can see on the bottom middle photo, a person actually built one of these microscopes that Antonie van Leeuwenhoek described. That's how it looked. It was a really tiny thing. You had to hold it really close to your eye and strain your eye. And with that instrument, Antonie van Leeuwenhoek looked at a lot of different samples that he took from his environment. He looked at water from lakes and he saw little things in there. And he described it in letters that he wrote to the Royal Academy in London. And he saw these wonderful structures that nobody had ever seen before. And one of the interesting experiments that he described in great detail was that he didn't brush his teeth for a couple of days. And of course, back then they didn't have toothbrushes or toothpaste like we have now, but they cleaned their teeth with a piece of cloth that they would sort of rub against their teeth. And he didn't do that for a couple of days. And you can imagine that all things started to grow there. And he took some scrapings from his teeth and looked at that under his microscope. And what he described there is seen on the slide, in the picture on the right. He described it really well. And we know now what those are. Those are mouth bacteria. We actually recognize all the shapes that they have and how that some of them are motile or spiraling shaped. And he really described mouth bacteria. So that was a really cool experiment. But he probably didn't realize what these things were and how important they are for our health. And if you now move forward to 2015, this is the type of image we can now make with microscopy. So this is an amazing picture from the Sonnenberg lab at Stanford, where they looked at a section of it's actually a mouse gut. But it's a little section that you can see on the right in the yellow square, a section of the colon. And on the left panel, you can see the blue part of the slide. That's the mouse epithelium, so that's the part of the mouse. And then on the left part you can see the bacterial communities that live in the gut. And they're colored according to all the different groups, bacterial groups, that live in the mouse gut or in the human gut, firmicutes, bacterial yeasts, and other bacteria in different colors. And you can also see that in between these bacteria and the host epithelium, there's a thick layer of mucus coated in green. That mucus layer is to keep sort of a balance between the host and these bacteria. Even though these bacteria are good for us and they have, we need them, we also want to not have those bacteria really touching our cells. So the human and any mammal host will make this thick mucus layer that is believed to sort of keep a balance between the bacteria and the host cells and put them at somewhat of a distance. And so this thick mucus layer is an important thing, and it's believed that if you have a healthy gut, this mucus layer is supposed to be very thick. But if you have what's called a leaky gut, where there's maybe holes in between the epithelial cells where bacteria can actually enter some of our own body, then that will elicit a low-grade immune response from our body. That is not a good thing. In those cases, you'll see a very thin mucus layer. So the thickness of the mucus layer is sort of a rough indicator of good gut health. So how do we study which bacteria and other microbes are present in these complex communities? So there's a couple of different approaches. So like Antonie van Leeuwenhoek, we can do microscopy. And we can try to describe all the different bacteria and all the different shapes and sizes that we see. But of course, that's not a very objective thing. One person might see more types of bacteria than another person. Another approach to looking at which bacteria are there is by plating on agar plates, also a very popular thing. And you'll definitely see a lot of different shapes and colors there. And again, you can try to describe if one person has more bacterial types than another person, but you can, it sort of becomes very hard because, you know, some of the colonies are might be interpreted as different, while another person might call them the same. So it's, again, not very objective. But recent developments in molecular biology have opened up the microbial world in a much more objective way, because now we can sequence the DNA of the bacteria. And we do that with a couple of different techniques that I'll talk about in my next slide. So what we do to analyze these communities is, first of course, we take a human sample that can be a nose swab to look at respiratory bacteria, we can take an oral swab, we can take a vaginal swab, or we can take a stool sample, and those all need to be extracted. We need to look at which, we need to break down the cell wall of the bacteria to extract the DNA, so we'll be able to analyze that. So after DNA extraction, and there's a couple of popular kits on the market that do a very good job in opening up pretty much all bacteria, then the next step is to either sequence all the DNA in there, which is called metagenomics, or to focus on one particular gene that all living organisms have, which is a ribosomal gene, and I'll talk about that in the next slide, and just analyze these sequences and then compare them to databases. And in that way, we can see which microbes are there. By simply counting all the sequences that are obtained, we can, let's say, sequence techniques are now really developed so much in the past couple of years, we can get like 100 million reads out of a single sample. And we can count how many reads of one particular bacterium and how many reads of another bacterium are there. And in that way, we can objectively compare different samples to each other. So we can make tables where we can plot the number of samples versus the number of different bacteria and compare these matrices to each other. So most time of these analyses of microbial communities is spent in the bioinformatics, where we can do a lot of statistical analyses and plotting of these microbial communities and try to visualize them. So talking a little bit about the gene that we amplify, or most people amplify to look at the composition of these microbial communities, the gene that most people use is the 16S gene, which is one of the components of the ribosome, which is involved in protein synthesis. So it's an essential function of the cell. And every human, animal, plant, or bacterial cell will have genes that encode for these structural RNAs. So the ribosomal RNAs are not RNAs that get translated into a protein. They're structural RNAs. Once they're an RNA, they'll just have, they sort of function as a scaffold where all different proteins can fit on. And they form these complex folded molecules. And the sequences of these molecules differ between different hosts. So on the right, top right panel, you can see the bacterial sequence, and you can see how conserved it is along the length of the 16S gene. And you can see that there's certain parts that are sort of valleys. So certain parts of the genes are very variable between different bacterial species, while other parts are very conserved. And so we can use this mosaic composition of the 16S gene to design PCR primers that we can use to amplify particular regions, because these primers will fit on any bacteria, while the regions in between are variable. So if we sequence those PCR products, we can compare them to databases, and there's now over 3 million sequences in the three million different bacterial sequences in the databases. And you can really tell bacteria apart by looking at these 6NF sequences. And another method of analyzing these communities, which is becoming rapidly popular as the sequence capacity increases, is metagenomics, where we can sequence all the genes out of a community and try to piece together the chromosomes that they came from. So with these molecular techniques, we have figured out a lot, and we've learned a lot about the microbial communities in the human body. We know that they differ per site, so we'll have different microbial communities in different anatomical sites, and you can actually tell if a microbial community is a stool community or an oral community, for example. They're very different. We also know that we differ from person to person, and that every person has a different microbiome. If you, for example, look at the plot on the right, you'll see all these different dots, and every dot is a microbial community from a different person. This is the American Gut and the Human Microbiome Project combined, data from thousands of individuals. And you can see, for example, if you look at fecal samples, you can see that they cluster together. All fecal samples are sort of similar to each other, but one person, one dot, might be very different from another dot. So you can tell that a sample is from a stool, for example, but you cannot tell from who it is, and you can probably not really guess that. And we are actually as different from the inside as we are from the outside. We all have different stool communities that are unique for our body. And that's pretty cool, but it also tells us that since we are different from each other, it's probably very hard to define a healthy microbiome. Assuming most of us are healthy, if we would take all our stool samples, we wouldn't really see a pattern that we all have in common. You would see some general things, but you cannot really say, oh, you should have these and these bugs in your body and then you're healthy. That's a very hard question to answer. But there are some differences in certain diseases. We have seen slight shifts of microbial communities. And so we hope to look at really large, you really have to look at large numbers of stool samples to tell a person apart, to tell health apart from disease, because we're also different from each other. And the colonization of our bodies actually starts at birth. So the second we're born, we're still believed to be born sterile. And the second that a baby is born the natural way, it will pick up vaginal and fecal bacteria from the mother as it passes through the birth canal. And this is a natural process. It picks up the first bacteria. It gets seeded with the bacteria from the mother. Later on, it gets seeded with bacteria that are present in breast milk by touching the baby. And so it gets slowly colonized in the first 3 years of life. The baby will develop its microbiome. And if you follow babies over time, you'll see these huge shifts in microbial communities and that are usually associated with lifetime events, such as an antibiotic course or switching from breast milk to solid foods. So those are accompanied by large changes in the baby's gut microbiome. A baby that is born via cesarean section will